tuning into Ag PhD. I'm Brian Hefty.
And I'm Darren Hefty. Thanks for joining us. We are very lucky on our farm this year. We got all our crop in, but we've got some wheat that's going to come off pretty shortly, and we're going to have some ground that will be basically unprotected and not being used for a number of months. In that case, on our farm, it's a no-brainer. We're going to put a cover crop on. We're going to talk a little bit about cover crops, what the benefits are, and why you may consider that on your farm.
We're also going to discuss soybean aphids. It's a problem we've been dealing with for almost the last 15 years now, and prior to that, we'd never had a problem before. This is a newer issue in agriculture, but it's a huge issue. If you don't treat, it could cost you big time yield. We'll talk about the right thresholds coming up later on the show.
We've got a weed of the week that many people think could be resistant to Roundup, but it has not been shown to be resistant. It's just pretty tolerant. We'll show you what can control our weed of the week later in the show, but first, here's today's Farm Basics.
Farm Basics is brought to you by the Liberty Link Trait and Liberty Herbicide from Bayer. The most reliable weed management solution, Liberty Link and Liberty Herbicide are the link to efficient row crop production and sustainable weed management.
During our Farm Basics time today, we're going to talk about corn tasseling.
Well, it seems kind of a stretch when we're in this field of corn that was planted late. It's small, but in some areas of the country, corn's been tasseling for a long time. When we think about corn, the way that corn grows, it grows through all the vegetative stages first, then it hits the reproductive stages at the end of the season. That all begins when those tassels come out, because that's where the pollen is on corn plants.
What happens then with this pollen, once there's pollen shed, in effect, this pollen coming off the tassel, it's going to land on the silk. And we just want you to understand what these silks actually are. It's basically a tube for fertilization from where a kernel is going to develop. So every individual silk will attach down into that corn ear where a kernel is going to develop. That tube, in effect, goes all the way out, catches the pollen, and each individual silk has to get fertilized for that kernel to grow. Once the kernel has been pollinated, in effect, then that silk detaches itself, and that's when the silk dies, because it is now detached from the plant. So once it's dying, then eventually it's going to turn brown. So as farmers, we talk about the brown silk stage. Once you see brown silks out in your field, you know that every one of those silks got fertilized, it pollinated, the ear is now getting fully formed because each individual kernel is getting formed and the silks have detached from the ear.
Tasseling is one of those critical weather times in a corn crop, because we need to have weather that's not too hot and too dry. So if farmers get cool weather and get a little bit of rain when their corn is tasseling and starting to shed pollen, that really helps improve how that corn does in terms of pollinating that ear. So this is one of those times, if we get really stressful weather, it can damper our yield expectations pretty quickly, and you'll see that many times during the summer. If we get that hot, dry spell at the wrong time, it can really affect things.
The other thing to think about here is tasseling occurs after a certain number of heat units. So with corn, since it does develop based on heat, once we have achieved a total amount of heat during the season, then we've had all the leaf stages occur, we've had tasseling occur, and tasseling is actually considered the last of the vegetative stages. Silking, when the silks start to come out, that's considered the first stage of reproduction in the corn plant, even though I just find it funny because already at V3 with a tiny little plant, we've got ear shoots initiated.
You know, the other thing when we're talking about that end of the vegetative stages, that's really where corn quits trying to increase the root mass. Now that root mass is just being used to feed the ear after that. So it is this time in a corn plant's life where there's this big changeover. Instead of worrying about growing big and tall and growing a great big root system, now all the energy gets focused to making an ear.
Well, once again, corn tasseling is a tremendously important time in a corn plant's life. And if corn tasseling goes well, and pollen shed goes well, usually you end up with fairly decent yields.
Well, if you want good yields, you have to stop our weed of the week. We'll show you how coming up later in the show.
What's next in weed control technology? Roundup Ready 2 Extend Soybeans will provide tolerance to dicamba and glyphosate and will be built on the Genuity Roundup Ready to Yield trait. See them in action at extendfollowafield.com.
Could I boost my potential by foliar feeding?
You can.
Foliar feeding can correct nutrient deficiencies and sustain your crop through stress. It's a great way to deliver nutrients that your crop lacks to reach its full potential. Research proves it. Applied alone or in combination with your crop protection program, AgroLiquid products assure that when the season presents opportunity, you can boost your crop's yield potential by foliar feeding. For more info, visit agroliquid.com.
Wake up. Breakfast is served. Your roots crave pee. Most of your applied pee gets tied up in the soil, a natural phenomenon known as phosphorus fixation. Fix the problem with Avail Phosphorus Fertilizer Enhancer. Avail makes more pee available to your roots. Here, here, and here. Increasing pee availability can lead to increased pee uptake in the plant. That's more pee, more pee, and more pee. More phosphorus for your crop can mean more results in your bin. An average of 9.6 bushels per acre of corn. Breakfast is served. Supercharge your pee with Avail.
Experience matters in farming. And when it comes to efficient power, no one has more experience than Case IH. Our industry-leading SCR engine technology has powered over 35,000 pieces of equipment and has over 17 million operating hours in North America alone. It was the right solution from the start, and it's proving itself right again as our new generation of Tier 4B equipment takes to the field. Proven power, proven efficiency, proven in the field. Case IH. Be ready.
Farmer's attention to detail is what makes the difference. You take the time for service management because you know how vital it is to your operation. You service your field like everything else because soil sampling makes all the difference and gets the results you want. Download the app Soil Test Pro and start grit sampling today. Keep your farm growing strong. The more you test, the more you know.
A proven herbicide for decades, dicamba can provide burn-down residual control of tough and resistant weeds for up to 14 days. That's another reason why farmers will use dicamba for years to come. Brought to you by Roundup Ready Plus Weed Management Solutions.
A couple of years ago, Case IH did this national survey of farmers asking them, well, what new practice are you going to implement on your farm? And the overwhelming number one choice was cover crops. Well, cover crops aren't exactly new. It's been there for centuries, but it just seems like the adoption is growing very quickly in the United States.
Well, we get so focused on trying to make our land profitable for us. So what crop can I raise that will take advantage of the full growing season and deliver me the most money back? And when we think about a cover crop, it just is a whole different process of thinking, because now we're looking at what can I do to protect my soil for whatever period of time there isn't a crop growing
and help me get a better yield, not only next year, but for many years down the road. If, for example, you build the organic matter in your soil, you're going to reap long-term benefits out of that, 20, 30, 50 years out of that. So, I mean, it's just a big picture way of thinking of things. But yes, I mean, even protecting the soil, that does become a big issue. We as farmers don't want erosion, so you might pick a cover crop that's going to help you there. Another thing we've done on our farm is picked either turnips or radishes to try to break through compaction. That's important. You might also pick a legume crop. We just have used old soybeans we weren't able to plant, or leftover soybeans we had, and thrown those out there, helping to add more nitrogen to the soil. There are so many different potential benefits from cover crops. We do think it's important that every farmer takes a look at this.
Well, the other thing is, what kind of cover crop are you going to plant? And you mentioned, well, you might put a legume out there, or you might put a grass out there. I mean, there's it's a number of different species that you could be using. So most farmers that are doing cover crops are using some sort of a blend. And, you know, a lot of times when farmers will get started with cover crops, they'll say, well, I don't know exactly which one or two to use. Picking a blend kind of helps you out too, because now you can look at a variety of different plants out in your field and say, hey, you know what? Those radishes really looked pretty good out there for me, or they did X, Y, and Z for my soil, or the turnips did this or that, or putting grass out there really held my soil in place. I mean, you just have to work with an agronomist a little bit and say, all right, what different benefits do I need in my ground? Maybe it's, I've been too wet this year. I need something that's going to be a high user of water to try and dry that soil out a little bit. Or it could be the opposite. You're in a dry part of the country, see a lot of cover crops going into arid climates, and guys say, I want to preserve the moisture in my field.
Well, this list of benefits we talk about with cover crops, you can find that on agphd.com under the resources tab. I do think it's important that you consider all all the different potential benefits, but one of the most important things we want you to look at is if you weren't able to plant a crop, let's say in a prevent plant situation, or there are a lot of guys that do this wheat fallow type rotation, we don't like to see that. The reason why is because what happens in a fallow situation, even if it's only fallow for a couple, 3 months, you're gonna have fewer beneficial microbes left alive in that soil. They need something to feed on. They need a crop, a plant to feed on. So mycorrhiza fungi, for example, and I know we start talking about some of these things, you say, well, I don't really know about that. It's hard for me to understand that. Don't get me wrong, we farm too. It's real easy when I go out, I'm gonna kill a weed. Hey, it's dead. I see, yeah, that was great. Okay, but how about tiny little microbes, fungi and bacteria in the soil? You don't see that. You don't exactly know what's going on, but just understand when you read about these things and all the research that has been done, things like mycorrhiza fungi are unbelievably important in helping nutrients get into plants. Without those beneficial fungi and bacteria, you're going to have far fewer nutrients getting into the plant, even with the same number of total nutrients in the soil. So you want to have those things alive and growing into the next season. That's why they talk about fallow syndrome all the time. What fallow syndrome is basically is dead mycorrhiza fungi, the mycorrhiza fungi that didn't survive. They can't help your next crop. So your next crop, even though there's phosphorus in the soil, it doesn't get into the plant. So your plant turns purple. We don't want fallow syndrome. We don't want you to have those issues. Put a cover crop out there and at least your next crop is going to be better than if you left that as true fallow.
Well, the big thing is, you know, there are lots of benefits with cover crops. It just takes a little bit of time to get the full effect of what those cover crops can do. Now, that's not saying that if you only had a couple of weeks and you got grass up and growing, hey, you did protect yourself for a short period of time. But to get the maximum growth, most of the cover crops you're going to plant will need 60 days to get fully established and get deep roots.
Yeah, and so like in our area where we have corn and soybeans coming off late in the fall and then it's going to freeze up, it's not going to work very well. But
well, not to wait until after you harvest, but what many guys are doing is trying to experiment with putting aerial seeding or even using ground rigs to run through and seed in between the rows of crop, you know, early, right about the time in soybeans, for example, when you start seeing some leaves start to turn yellow, here's your shot. Get out there.
That's fine, Darren, in a year where we're going to have early harvest and when we have a warm summer. In 2012, for example, and just about everything was off in September, yeah, we've got a couple of months after that, after harvest. But most years, we don't have a couple of months after harvest. It's not going to do you a lot of good. But there are tremendous amounts of acres of small grain or areas in our country where we do harvest corn and soybeans early enough that a cover crop would be beneficial.
Well, there's certainly a lot of reasons you may consider using a cover crop on your farm. For me, the big thing is just keeping something growing in your field as much of the year as you possibly can. That really helps the microbes in your soil, and that's going to impact your crop for years to come. The other thing is just protecting your soil, holding it in place, stopping erosion, whether it's from wind or rain. Cover crops can serve many purposes on your farm.
Well, one of the purposes that cover crops can serve is keeping weeds down, like our Weed of the Week. Can you identify this week's weed?
Being a farmer means securing your land and livelihood for the future. Harvest Solutions from Capello USA have the grit to get you there. Our product lines for corn, sunflowers, and forage are designed for efficiency and longevity, preventing harvest loss while minimizing maintenance and downtime. To do everything you can to advance your farmland to the next generation, call us at 855-CAPELLO or visit us at capellousa.com. Capello USA, Italian craftsmanship, American grit.
Looking to maximize yield? Quick Roots is a microbial seed inoculant that allows the plant root to explore a greater volume of soil, the key to higher yields. Quick Roots continues to generate yield response on corn, soybeans, wheat, and more. Quick Roots is applied to the seed so the live microorganisms go right to work, enhancing seedling vigor, increasing the uptake of certain nutrients, including NPK, and expanding root volume. Maximize yield on your farm this season. Call TJ Technologies or your local dealer and get your Quick Roots today.
Get the most from the genetic potential in your crops, reduce plant stress, and increase yield. BioForge upregulates key genes to keep roots growing and reduce ethylene for improved plant stress tolerance. BioForge mixes well with other products for easy application with every pass through the field. BioForge, progressive growers' choice to improve root growth, reduce crop stress, and increase yield. Make every growing day count with BioForge from Stoller USA.
The world of farming is changing. Titan Machinery and Case IH are here to make sure you're ready. The demands on agriculture keep growing. The challenge for producers is to continue to keep pace. To be successful, you'll need equipment that can get the most out of every inch of land, innovations that help you work faster, and advice from people who know your field as well as they know your equipment. Don't get left behind. Be ready with Case IH and Titan Machinery. Better solutions.
If you watch Ag PhD TV, you'll love the new Ag PhD radio show each weekday on Rural Radio Sirius XM Channel 80. This is Darren Hefty. On the new Ag PhD radio program, we'll take live callers and provide the agronomic information and brotherly banter you've come to expect from Ag PhD. We'll feature a Back 40 segment where we talk to farmers and agronomists around the country to share what's going on with crop production. And it wouldn't be Ag PhD without addressing a pest of the day. Tune in to the Ag PhD radio show each weekday at 2 p.m. Central on Rural Radio Sirius XM Channel 80.
Soybean aphids, it's one of my favorite topics to talk about because we've had such tremendous yield gains when we control this pest early at low thresholds.
Well, the other way to look at it, Brian, is think about the yield we've lost since we've started having soybean aphids. Yep. Back in the days where we really didn't fight aphids, I know growing up and even, you know, I think back 15, 20 years ago, we didn't have any aphids at all. And we hardly sprayed for bugs unless we had grasshoppers or something unusual in our soybeans. And as soon as we had aphids, we were seeing guys lose 10, 15 bushels really easy and having lots of disease issues starting to pop up in soybeans.
Yeah, and even if you do happen to control this pest fairly early, you don't see a lot of aphids out there. I mean, even a low threshold, we might spray at 10, 20, 30 aphids per plant. Well, just think about that over an entire acre. How many plants do you have out there? Multiply that times 10, 20, or 30. You might have millions of aphids on a per acre basis. That's a lot of bugs that are feeding on plants. It's going to open it up for disease. So I think personally, that's one of the reasons why fungicides have paid so well over the last few years. Even if you only had a few aphids per plant, it's going to open it up for disease. You're much more likely to get that fungicide to pay.
All right, there's been a lot of debate on this topic, Brian. Let's just get right into it. Economic thresholds for treatment with soybean aphids. Well, I'm just surprised some of these recommendations haven't changed, that it's still the same amount of aphids before you treat.
Yep, all right, so here's my big complaint with this whole economic threshold thing. If you go back to the early 2000s when aphids were first getting going and everybody said, okay, 250 aphids is the threshold. Well, I thought that was wrong back then, but even let's say that it was right. Back then we were dealing with roughly $5, $6 soybeans and we were dealing with a treatment cost of somewhere in the $7, $8 range just for the insecticide alone. Oh, and by the way, our yield was less. So if you just strictly look at economics, let's just run the simple math. If let's say beans were in the $5 to $6 range back then, and now they're in the $10 to $12 range today, then by very virtue of the definition of economic threshold, it must change when the economics change. So if it took 250 aphids and now your crop is worth twice the money per bushel, then that threshold should be cut in half if you run the very simple math. So now I'm down to 125 aphids per plant. Okay, then you look at the cost of treatment. It only costs $2 an acre to use silencer as opposed to back then where it might have cost $6 to $8. Let's figure on the low side. Let's figure $6. So it costs one-third the amount of money for the insecticide. Now, if you want to say, well, you've got to figure the cost of spraying in there and, you know, to run a sprayer now costs a lot more than it did back then, fine. But still, you're probably looking at half the total cost you were back in the early 2000s. So now you got to take your 125 number, divide that by two, you're down to 60, 65 aphids per plant. And we haven't even accounted for the fact that back then we were going for 40 or 50 bushel beans. Now on our farm, we're getting pretty consistent 60 bushel yields and more. So everything has changed. All right, why has the economic threshold not changed? Why do people still continue to talk about 250 aphids? Obviously, it's not an economic threshold. That's what I'm trying to tell you. If you want to use an economic threshold, great, do so. But there's no possible way it's still 250 when the economics have changed.
One thing that changed in the soybean breeding programs, and this happened at least a decade ago, is that the researchers started looking for resistance genes for aphids because that was the big demand. When it cost quite a bit of money to spray for aphids and we noticed that there was such a huge yield loss when we had problems, farmers were just clamoring, hey, we have to have something. We have to have a resistance option. And researchers did find resistance genes for aphids. However, the aphids adapt so quickly quickly, and there's such a large population that they were developing resistance to those resistance genes very quickly. Now, there are some of the RAG1 products still out on the market with that resistant trait, and it does help. It certainly knocks down the numbers a little bit on the aphids, but it's not going to be complete resistance where you say, I don't have to scout anymore. I didn't even have to think about it. You still have to scout. Chances are you're still going to have to treat on those years where there's lots of pressure, but it certainly is something that helps if you can find a variety that yields and works for your farm.
The other thing that's going to knock the populations down is if you use a good seed treatment that contains one of those neonicotinoid insecticides like Poncho, Gaucho, or Cruiser, you're not going to get all your aphids, but a lot of times we'll see the numbers cut in half, so that can be a good thing as well. Once again, soybean aphids can be the worst problem you've got on your farm if you're trying to raise a good soybean crop. Not only do they harm your yield, but they can also introduce disease into your field that makes your yield even less. Get these under control fairly early at relatively low thresholds and consider the new Transform that does not kill lady beetles.
Well, another big yield robber is our weed of the week. We'll show you how to stop it coming up next.
Your time is valuable. That's why you need a Hagee STS application system. Hagee STS products are designed for precision and efficiency, allowing you to make applications all season long with just one machine. Contact your Hagee rep today.
Our weed of the week is Lambsquarters.
This is probably the first broadleaf weed, I should say the second broadleaf weed I was ever able to identify. Milkweed was certainly the easiest one for me. You break the plant, milk comes out, pretty obvious. But Lambsquarters look so unique. When you look at the top of the plant, a lot of times you'll see that silvery dust right towards the middle on the top cluster of leaves. And to me, that was just a dead giveaway. That silvery looking weed, that's Lambsquarters.
Usually we would find Lambsquarters where we had spread lots of manure. So we called it one of the manure weeds. Here's the thing with Lambsquarters. Even a tiny plant is going to have lots of growing points, and that's why it's so difficult to control. Not only that, but it has lots of hairs on the leaves, so sometimes it's hard to get some of the spray down into that actual leaf or onto the leaf to get good control. In broadleaf crops, this is where it's toughest. We suggest a 3-pre strategy in soybeans if Roundup isn't doing a good job on your farm. Use one of the yellows or DNA products, Treflansonilan or Prowl, then add a little bit of Metribuzin, that's the old Sencor, and a PPO, either Valor or Authority. Post-emerge, the reason why we're talking about this weed today is we've got a lot of farmers around the country that are struggling with Lambsquarters. It's popping up late post. Harass is really the best thing you can use. That's the generic version of that old Pinnacle. You probably remember that from 20 years ago. It's pretty good. It might stunt your beans just a little bit, so spray it fairly soon. Get it out of the way relatively early. It's a good product if that Lambsquarters plant is real small.
And once Lambsquarters gets big, it's tough. Too. It's very inexpensive.
Yeah, you're going to spend $1 an acre or less on harass.
You know, there aren't a lot of choices post-emerge in soybeans, but fortunately in other crops there are. When we look at corn, many of the pre-emerge products do a nice job on Lambsquarters. Your Harness and Surpass are probably the best of the pre's that can do 80% to 90% control on Lambsquarters if you're using them at full labeled rates. I like those combination pre's, things like Verdict, Corvus, Triple Flex, Sure Start. We do a nice job on Lambsquarters, and post-emerge Status is our favorite choice. The HPPDs, Callisto, Laudis, Impact, Armazon, they do a nice job when you're mixing a quarter to a half pound of atrazine with them. And really, Buctrol is probably the best one as far as contact activity on Lambsquarters.
Well, Buctrol is not the best one. I really like Status a lot better than that. But with any of these, if you add a little bit of atrazine, you're going to have slightly better control. But yeah, it's not that difficult in corn. Turning to wheat, we really like Sharpen pre-emerge and then follow post-emerge with Husky.
That's all the time we have for this week's weed, but Iron Talk is coming up next.
Iron Talk is brought to you by Case IH.
Our industry-leading SCR technology has powered over 35,000 pieces of equipment with over 17 million operating hours in North America alone. Case IH, proven power, proven efficiency. Proven in the field.
Should you upgrade to a self-propelled sprayer? From the time Brandon and I were pretty young, our dad spoke to us about finding $100 an hour jobs and doing them ourselves. We'll show you one of those jobs in today's Iron Talk. If you're spending $5 to $8 an acre on custom application with a ground rig, you need to analyze what you're really spending. Most custom app rigs will cover 60 to 100 acres per hour. Let's take the low end of the price and acres covered for this example. If your custom applicator charges you $5 an acre and sprays 60 acres per hour, that's a job that costs your farm $300 an hour. You've got to do that yourself if you want to maximize your profitability. The question then becomes, should you get a sprayer that your tractor can pull through the field or a self-propelled model? Historically, 10,000 acres covered has been the guideline for buying a self-propelled sprayer. Let's say that you run 2,500 acres. You may qualify. You run one pass with a burndown or pre-plant residual herbicide, a second pass with an in-crop weed spray, a third pass with insecticide and fungicide, a fourth pass with your second in-crop herbicide spray, and potentially even a fifth time with a foliar treatment, a late insecticide application, or who knows what else. At four passes, you're already at 10,000 acres covered in one season. Of course, you could take a job spraying for a neighbor or two. Many farmers choose to apply pre-emerge herbicides for others since they have extra time to do it before planting. At 80 acres per hour, you could cover 600 to 1,000 acres in a day, which goes a long ways towards making a sprayer payment at $5 an acre. Here are some other reasons that you want to own your own sprayer. Timely application. You can buy your chemicals from anywhere you want. Keep a hired hand busy year-round. Spray late-season applications with a self-propelled high-clearance sprayer. Save lots of money, or even just keep your son or daughter employed on your farm. Spraying is a several hundred dollar per hour job that you must do on your farm to maximize profitability. When you consider multiple passes that you make on every acre, you may be able to justify a self-propelled sprayer to cover ground even more quickly. That's all for today's Iron Talk, and now back to the show.
Experience matters in farming, and when it comes to efficient power, no one has more experience than Case IH. Our industry-leading SCR engine technology has powered over 35,000 pieces of equipment and has over 17 million operating hours in North America alone. It was the right solution from the start, and it's proving itself right again as our new generation of Tier 4B equipment takes to the field. Proven power, proven efficiency, proven in the field. Case IH. Be ready.
Can I grow my crop without the expense of fertilizer additives?
You can. Conditions forcing you to make some tough choices? Choose agriculture liquid fertilizers and you won't need stabilizers or nutrient managers, eliminating expense and hassle. Millions of acres and years of replicated research have proven that with ProGerminator, SureK, High Energy In, and MicroLink, you can grow a great crop without costly additives. To learn more and find a dealer near you, visit agroliquid.com.
A farmer's attention to detail is what makes the difference. You take the time for service management because you know how vital it is to your operation. You service your field like everything else because soil sampling makes all the difference and gets the results you want. Download the app Soil Test Pro and start grid sampling today. Keep your farm growing strong. The more you test, the more you know.
If you could see how nitrogen loss causes yield loss, you'd fix it. So fix it right, with the stabilizer proven to reduce all three ways nitrogen escapes. Nutrisphere N Nitrogen Fertilizer Manager. It keeps nitrogen in a more readily available form longer. With today's market and environment, it's a high priority to keep your nitrogen on track. To higher yield with Nutrisphere N.
Dirty work pays. That is if your dirty work includes a Soil Max Gold Digger tile plow. Soil Max tile plows feature zero deflection technology. With the only tile plow factory paired with Ag Leader's IntelliSlope control system, you eliminate the need for grade calculations and lasers. So make your next investment in a Soil Max Gold Digger. Better yield, longer planting and harvest windows, better water management is all yours with Soil Max. Visit SoilMax.com.
Closed captioning for Ag PhD is sponsored by Norwood Sales.
The all-new S-Cube Commercial Tender is the only tender on the market with poly tanks, giving you the capability to haul seed, fertilizer, water, or liquid fertilizer. Each cube can hold 300 units of seed, 2,000 gallons of liquid, or 300 cubic feet of fertilizer. Options include full-functioning wireless remote, stainless steel conveyors, and self-contained hydraulics. Get yours today at Norwood Sales.
That's all the time we have for today's show, but we invite you to tune in each weekday to Ag PhD Radio for more agronomic information. Our show is at 2 p.m. Central, 3 p.m. Eastern. It's a one-hour live daily show where we answer your phone calls and take your questions.
And don't forget to watch Ag PhD TV next week for another Weed of the Week, Farm Basics, Iron Talk, and a whole lot more. I'm Darren Hefty.
And I'm Brian Hefty. Thanks for watching Ag PhD.
What's so sweet about manure? Animals eating prairie grass and returning nutrients to the soil through manure is the way nature is intended to work. To learn more about manure and how farmers use it to raise crops, visit the Responsible Nutrient Management Foundation at rnmf.org.